Between the Sage abilities and their attacks in combat, it's unclear how much damage these guys are really doing. We're gonna take a thorough dive into the stats behind all of them, for understanding and utilizing them best in battle. We'll be splitting this up into four separate parts, starting with their abilities. Riju's Lightning Blast is typically the most punishing, dealing up to 105 damage to whoever gets struck. But this blast is made up of three damaging parts, the Explosion, which deals 70 damage, the Electrical damage, which deals 20, and the Fire part, which deals up to 15, depending on the enemy, as goons like Constructs and Bokoblins are slightly more fire resistant, therefore taking a bit less damage. A similar logic also applies to enemies that are fully elemental resistant, like Lynels, so they take none of the shock or fire portions, and only the 70 explosion damage. Just be careful of enemies charged with electricity, as they are completely immune to all damage in Riju's attack. On the contrary, Queen Gibdo specifically takes enhanced damage to Riju's blast, totaling to 210 per strike. Also, you have a lot of time to work with, as Lightning Dome will continue to expand for 20 solid seconds before disappearing, and it's only on a 10 second recharge. But one good thing to note is that the damage of these blasts is additive with the damage of the arrow, so getting a direct hit is always ideal, especially with a high damaging bow. Another ability is far more contingent on the value of your attacks, and that is Sidon's. It's known that you can shoot water beams with it, with the size and speed changing with the weapon type, between one-handed, two-handed, and spears, but the actual damage of this beam is exactly reflective of the weapon you shoot it with. So an 138 damage sword attack will shoot out a 138 damage beam, and this will work with attack buffs, as it's just mirroring your attack, making it the only Sage attack that is affected by the buff. Since this attack can be used in tandem with a normal hit to effectively do a double damage strike, it does also drain one durability point away with each use. But of course, Sidon's ability is multi-purpose, and upon activating gives a wetness effect that can be applied again immediately after wearing off, which makes you immune to the hot desert, volcanic zones, and is awesome for extended combat with Zoro weapons. This water bubble, when active, can also coat arrow fusions with wetness, which allows you to do things like firing bomb arrows in volcanic areas instead of blowing yourself up, and this also gives shock fusions immediate conductive domes, without the need of shooting a puddle or metal object. Oh, and yeah, this ability is also a one-layer shield too, great for baiting enemies into you like a Molduga, and coming out scratch-free for a counter-attack, just like you could with Druk's Protection in Breath of the Wild. Which, yeah, another shield-like ability is found within Yobo, who can be picked up to effectively block rain shots in the direction you're facing. Which is clearly not the main point of this ability, as his Rolling Smash can hurl at enemies for 24 points of damage, on top of the added fire damage that works just like Riju's. But despite Yobo's lower damage, you can make up for this with his fire rate, as when used on any type of controlled vehicle, this ability ignores its recharge time in favor of the speed it takes for Yobo to travel back, which allows for rapid fire when used precisely. This is really fun for enemies, but best to use against rocks, as Yobo's impacts are special enough to shatter even the toughest rocks in one go, whereas other explosions only deal their base value, which often can't one-shot the tougher boulders. But there is one more important stat that can make Yobo even stronger, and to explain it, we'll first need to go over how upgrading a Sage affects their stats, with the Sage's Wills and Champion Helmets. So when you first get a Sage, it'll always start at its base level, but there are two levels beyond this that it can be upgraded to. The first boost can be achieved by either upgrading it with the Sage's Wills, which is a permanent upgrade, or by currently wearing the corresponding Champion's Helmet, which is a temporary one. But by having both of these active at once, you can have the Sage in its strongest possible state. We'll just call these levels 1, 2, and 3 respectively. These levels mainly affect the damage that a Sage deals when attacking foes with their weapons, which varies per Sage, but very uniquely for Yobo, also buffs his ability damage as well. So at level 1, his impact deals 24 damage as we stated, but level 2 increases it to 35 damage, while a max level 3 increases it to 48, which brings it more on par with the other combat abilities. It should be stated that these level upgrades also have a clear upgrade pattern. In this case, each level adds 50% more damage to the base, effectively doubling its damaging potential from base to max. And more uniquely so, Yobo's impact damage stat is always identical to the damage he deals with his hammer in combat, just minus the added fire portion, so this is really just his own brute strength at play. But the other Sages have completely unique attack stats compared to their abilities, as Riju's swords will strike at an enemy for 17 damage at its base, 25 damage at level 2, and 34 damage at max, which follows the same 50% upgrade pattern as Yobo. But uniquely, this only refers to her two-sword sweeping attack, as a lot of the time she attacks with volleys of single slashes, which deal half of the damage per hit. This makes sense, as it's only one sword per hit instead of two. But one that's more peculiar has to be Sidon, whose spear attacks may follow a similar upgrade pattern, with 20 damage at the base and 40 at level 3, but these values don't refer to the damage of each spear jab, but rather the total damage of each spear combo. So let's say a maxed out Sidon who deals 40 damage does a single jab attack. This will deal the 40 damage. But if he goes in with his 4 hit multi-jab attack, the total damage done will still be 40, but at a rate of 10 damage per hit. So there's sadly no point in hoping for him to do bigger combos, as it's all flair with no edit substance. From a stat perspective, there is a very precise way this damage per hit is calculated, which after the rounding makes some specific combos slightly more or less effective, but it's so minuscule that it's not worth mathing over. Now, there's a reason we save two sages for the end, and that is due to their complexity and off-patternness to the others. The first of which being Tulin, who may have the most straightforward ability, Wind Gust on a 15-second charge, but his bow stats are unlike any of the other weapons, as the first shot he always shoots in a volley is much stronger than his follow-ups. It's a 19 damage first shot and a 7 damage second or third shot, despite all these shots looking the same visually. And the upgrade pattern per sage tier is also odd, with a plus 7 damage per level increase for the first shot, and a plus 2 increase per level for the follow-ups. On top of this, all these values can potentially be doubled due to headshots, so between that and having some shots on a combo miss, the damage Tulin deals is hyper-varied, but at his most can deal far more than any of the others. Another unique thing about Tulin is that when you use him pre-sage, he only has his swallow bow, which deals a much lower 6 damage first shot with 2 damage follow-ups. This is the only sage that I am aware about that has different stats prior to obtaining their sage ability. And for more info on this, please check out the credited research in the description below. But finally, the sage with the most layers has to be the BattleBot herself, Mineru. Attacking with one of her base arms deals 27 damage, and this can be increased by 13 each level, up to 53. It doesn't matter if Link's controlling her or if she attacks on her own. Controlling is good though, as a player can do alternating 3-hit combos for the most attack speed. Where things get elaborate though is with the fusions, as they will add the corresponding damage to the base attack, plus another hidden 5%. The reason for this is that Mineru's arms are considered two-handed weapons, and just like other ones in the game and their fusions, only show 95% of the damage that they actually deal, so it's really just a small but apparent boost. What's really important here though is the durability of said fuses, as most material attachments you're going to use last for 10 swipes before disappearing, which include boss drops and monster horns. More useless materials like plants and meats will fittingly only have 5 durability instead. However, when it comes to most world objects, the durability of each depends on the material it's made of, as wooden objects last for 5 hits, most stone and zonai objects last for 10 hits, and metallic objects last for 15. This rule also applies to all shields and bows that are fused as well. But melee weapons specifically work off its own system, where most last for 15 hits before disappearing, unless the weapon's own durability stat is lower than this, in which case it'll disappear upon that. So an 8 durability Bodor will disappear in 8 hits, whereas a 40 durability Royal Claymore will disappear in 15 hits, as that's the max. With all this known, the most efficient fuses to maximize damage and minimize waste would be boss parts, assuming you would just leave them behind otherwise, and the gloom weapons, as these both deal high damage, and you're not cutting into your personal horn stash to feel a temporary damage up. Just keep in mind that a durability point is only drained once per damaging swing, so your potential can be stretched further by hitting multiple enemies at once, for the cost of only one durability. It's very handy. But this clearly is without considering one major category, the zonai devices, where a few of these boast unique rules. One is the cannon, where like other cannons can fire 12 damage explosions plus the varying fire damage, and 20 shots can be fired out of these before expiring. The emitters, including elemental, beam, and even the hydrants, last for 67 seconds each. Quite an odd number, but it equates to 2,000 frames in technical terms. In fact, this 67 seconds of duration is identical to nearly all time-limited fuses that Mineru has, such as the fan, which doubles running speed when activated. Other time-limited ones include all the slow fallers, such as hoverstones, balloons, and wings, with wings' added benefits of being able to ride updrafts while in midair. It's really cool. The only other noticeable stat to mention here is how her battery consumption works for all these one-eye objects, which besides her walking cost, which drains a battery every 40 seconds, has a unique drain speed for each and every Zone device used. So much to the fact that I won't list them all here, as there's already been a fantastic research project done on that, and the full video for it can be found in the description. But anyways, I hope you're now able to understand the Sages and Tears of the Kingdom, so thanks for watching! There's just so many interesting quirks on each angle of the game, and the research on them will only continue to grow. But as it does, be sure to check out past episodes in the Stats of the Kingdom playlist above and below. And thanks for watching! Hope to see you all in the next one. Goodbye!